When you support your local PBS station, you help make programs like this one possible.
My relationship with Africa began in Australia, where I studied African history at university. Eventually, my curiosity about the place drove me beyond books, and when I finished my degree, I arranged to do some volunteer work with an international aid organisation in a remote village in northern Zambia. I learned to cook mealie-meal, a local staple, and to carry water on my head from the river, more than a mile's walk from my home. These ways of life were new to me. But the style of dress in the village was oddly familiar. The village elder in the Chanel knockoff jacket, the woman in the AC/DC t-shirt, the children sporting Adidas. It became a great source of amusement to me to invent stories about the people who must have originally owned these clothes. And I wondered if they would be surprised to learn that the clothes they'd given away were now being sold all over Africa. Luka Mafo is a 19-year-old Zambian, and like many Zambians, he sells second-hand clothes to make a living. He buys the clothes a bale at a time in the capital city of Lusaka.
School is late. Me, kara grade 1, kutofita choroma grade 9. Asika kutela katene, minde nsepisa kuli. Sanikaranga kwa zangashwani. Kwa yanga maya marikota, kwa lula yanga marikota, kwa kushimanga fatu. Second month ni yola tenu wa mshitu. Kwa yaka kusasani, kwa zote mwendi 22 hours, kakubata upilo kuli. Tushere ngituwa la tuni yole kisa, tuni yole kisa rikota tuwani. Lui tusise. Kapanile kwa teni ndivuka. Na nisike na uzwa, kwa hali hapaka nitema. Ni kasi feza. Kwa grupi, wane ntoka kuli unita tafarezi. Chase ntoto wa skolo. Skolo ni silata.
It was in the Zambian markets that I first met sellers like Luca. Some had been nurses, teachers, civil servants, but now they were all in the markets, selling. And it began to dawn on me then just how big a business the secondhand clothes trade is. In Ghana, it's called dead white man's clothes. In Tanzania, dyed in Europe. In Zambia, it's known as Salaula, which translates to bend down boutique.
There are more people trading in secondhand clothes. We classify it as Salaula. People who are selling clothes actually seem to be in majority.
People are losing jobs now, so you can't just sit like that. So most of them have turned into business as the last resort.
A lot of people have been retrenched, so they've got nothing to do at home apart from selling.
So Salaula, it makes people feel easy to get into business. If somebody wants to enter into business, especially the Zambians, the first thing they'll look into is Salaula. It's keeping them going on, and that's the only trade that they can enter into. They cannot enter into any other trade, because with a bell of Salaula, one can start his own business. With two bells of Salaula, you go to an open space, you get your two bells, you start on the road, you start your business. If you make your profit, you make your money, well, it's good luck for you.
You know, green naive as tingan.
Shall you go Congresha?
Congore, no, prepay credit, no credit. Okay. I should say that it's not easy, it's rough. But since we have no other alternative, we have to struggle.
Right, they buy things, sell, and it's just a kind of hand-to-mouth business, not really something big. It's a hand-to-mouth business.
How, I wondered, did all of these Africans end up selling secondhand clothes? And where did all these T-shirts and jackets and hats come from?
Oh, I give it to Goodwill, yeah. Like every like year, my mom will say, get all your old stuff and we, you know, pack it up and give it to Goodwill.
I don't know, I think they give it to the charity or something.
If you give them Salvation Army or whatever, they can end up anywhere, I guess. People who need them.
You never know how far your clothes can go.
Africa, I can't see like nobody, like a tribe wearing my T-shirt or something, but I can see somebody wearing my T-shirt.
There's a big controversy over people shipping clothes overseas and selling it. Sure, it's a big market out there.
Salvation Army has retail stores every place where they sell some of this stuff. But probably 95% of what they get, they don't even unpack. These dealers, these factories, go to the Salvation Army and they buy these huge bales for anywhere between 10 and 15 cents a pound. Then they have their own trucks that come in, huge trailer trucks, come into the Salvation Army warehouse, load the trucks, take them down to their own factories. Once it leaves here, we have no control over what people do when it gets to another country. The largest export product from the United States to Africa in general is used clothing. So it's a huge business. It's a multi-billion dollar business. Yeah.
The consumers in the United States are extremely picky. And so you do have a lot of wastage of all sorts of merchandise. Any good business person is going to look at how can they minimize the loss from that. Or, you know, if Africa is there, that's the path of least resistance, I guess.
The people who make the real money in the secondhand clothes business are the commercial dealers, the ones who supply people like Luca, and who usually sell their bales with a markup of 300 to 400%.
To go into the business of Sarawura, where you have to import goods from outside the country, I think you require a lot of capital. And I don't think that the Zambian people do have that kind of money.
Black Zambian, if you will, has not been in the market or been in the business for very long. It's the Indians. They have been and are the main players.
You need a lot of capital. You need to have a good working force. You need to have your own warehouses. So a lot of them, after renting their shops, they go to London and settle. The one has to control the businesses here, make the local people work, and whatever money they send it out. That's the normal way what people are doing.
Some traders will allow you to see them. Others don't. It's a gamble.
Sometimes the bags are good. Sometimes you lose. As long as you get what you spent, then you go and buy another bag or another box.
So this is the story. We give our old clothes to charity, the charities sell them to the dealers, who sell them to people like Luca, who in turn sell them all over Africa. But what I wanted to know was, why were there no new clothes made by Africans?
Secondhand motor car tires, secondhand all sorts of things, secondhand cars, secondhand, you know, Africa is just becoming a dumping ground for everything secondhand. And one of the items that was not imported in the past was clothing. In 1991, this all changed. Now, as soon as liberalization took place, clothes started arriving in Zambia. But not only was it clothes, it's secondhand clothes. And they came by the container loads. Thousands and thousands of container loads of clothing was sent into Zambia. Every single clothing factory in Zambia went out of business. We do not have a clothing industry left in the country because the secondhand clothes are coming in.
When you look at this issue of why so much of Africa lacks competitive manufacturing sector. And garments is a good case because that's the kind of industry that poor countries can get started in. You find that the neglect and cynicism in the United States and Europe has been very, very high. We say, what do we care whether Africa develops a textile and garment sector?
From America, it's the one who's wearing.
But so lady.
Well, I think it's got a name of a basketball team. I think
where?
In Detroit, Michigan. Yeah.
The first thing Luca does when he gets back to Mongu is sort through his new bale. The better the quality of the clothes, the better his chances at beating out his competitors at the market. It's a 3-mile walk from the market stall Luca rents to the home he shares with his mother, his sister, his two brothers and his three cousins.
Piromane butata batuseba nyanda zeba nyanda kikuli kakuli nekeli kazeba tokwa likapeza zeba faba zeba zambia banazo na konja baka batise zaba mana hasili au baba fumia kuti babatise zeba ten zeba zambia bona kuna kubaka lizusa choko njikuli tanga foli kalika tanga kona chwe bakatofu mana chwe bupiro wangana
Well, parts of Africa is very poor. People, they really need clothes.
I guess if there's a need for them over there, that's okay too.
They're needy, correct? I would think. They need it.
they robbed Africa blind of all their riches and so forth and so on, you know. And now they coming through and they make it look like they're giving them, you know, respect, so forth and so on. You see, it's really not happening if you look deep, deep into it, you know.
Most people know that Africa is poor, dependent, needy. What most people don't know is that the industrialized countries of the north helped to make it that way. Africans weren't always wearing our cast-offs, and people like Luca weren't always selling them.
There is such a thing as slavery. There is such a thing as colonialism. These are historical facts. Anyone says the North has problems, North would have a lot more problems had it not profited from one of the greatest sins of history, slavery. We have to face that fact.
The most able-bodied Africans were shipped to the Americas to build the Americas. These countries were landed to the bone. Natural resources shipped out of our countries to build economies outside our continent. Our countries, Zambia for instance, was not colonized by a government. It was colonized by a company. But our first colonial masters were a corporate entity.
Under colonialism, Africa's interests came second, and predictably, those interests suffered. Tens of thousands of African men were sent to work in the colonial plantations and mines and were forced to leave their farms behind. For the first time in Africa's history, there was widespread famine.
This simple life under the hot African sky was once a life of fear and uncertainty.
British rule has brought peace. The enterprise of European officials and settlers and of Indian traders has opened up the country. But there is still a long battle to be fought with ignorance, poverty, and disease.
In these lands, where there are so many changes to be made, much can be achieved by money and the initiative of the white man.
Those who were privileged, in privileged positions, did not want to give up.
those privileges for the black man, history of slave trade, then colonization. It was a long and bitter struggle.
One man, one vote became the cry of the Africans from 1948, which got louder and stronger in the 50s until independence. The nationalists came into power, so then the government now were the ones controlling the mining companies.
In the 1960s, many African countries finally gained their political independence. But by then, their economies were totally dependent on the raw materials for which they'd been colonised. In Zambia's case, it was copper.
Zambia said, our priority now with independence is to develop. Zambia had copper revenue, so they were able to use savings from their mines in order to invest in industry, in schools, in health centers, and so forth.
The cry was health for all, education for all. And I can tell you it was so exciting because we were building hospitals in every province.
More kids were going to school, more people were getting health benefits, infrastructure was improving, and indeed the economic growth rates were also, in fact, rising.
By 1970, Zambia had a thriving textile industry, with 85 manufacturers employing over 10,000 people. But further development was going to be expensive, and the Zambian government was running out of money.
We refused to borrow until, bang, 1973, oil prices shot up sky high. So we were forced to borrow, because at the same time as oil prices were going high, copper prices were going down. So we're in a very, very precarious situation. I therefore wrote to both IMF and World Bank. We are in this situation now, can we borrow? Their reply was, well, look, we think that copper prices will soon rise again. So you may borrow, please feel free to do that. Oh, well.
To keep the industry moving and other services going, the government had to borrow at a very high interest rate. Now, over time, this has built up the debt stock that we have today.
African countries are absolutely buried in unpayable debt. Loans from the IMF, the World Bank, those have been coming for the last 20 years, but the projects that they've supported have not been successful. And sometimes the U.S. was knowingly lending to corrupt dictators as part of a Cold War strategy. Sometimes the World Bank had some scheme that it was trying to promote which didn't work, and the country ended up with a lousy project and with a mountain of debt. So some countries have just accumulated arrears that are mountainous now compared to any possibility to pay.
What happens when a country finds itself so deeply in debt? Well, first of all, the government has to send whatever money it can back to its creditors, which means it can no longer afford to invest much in services for its own people. For example, between 1990 and 1993, Zambia spent $37 million on primary school education and $1.3 billion on the repayment of debt. I saw for myself what happens after years and years of this. Schools don't have books, hospitals can't afford medicine, buildings and roads fall into disrepair. Basically, a country like Zambia just starts coming apart at the seams. The worst part of owing so much money is that Zambia's government can no longer determine its own economic policies. Instead, it must follow a set of rules called structural adjustment, that are imposed by its creditors, the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund.
And so began an effort in the 80s to reform these economies, open them up, and create more competitive structures.
The strategy has been, we'll give you a little bit of help, but clean up your act as we defined it. And that means do a set of economic policies that we think are what you need.
And we borrowed the money. So they're now imposing conditions on the basis that that is where, they, you know, if we follow their path, we will be able to generate enough income to repay their loans. You call the shots as a financier, and that's where we are.
Zambia's creditors claim that private investors would bring money into the country and help to diversify its economy. But many investors just stripped the national companies of their assets and sold them off. My Zambian friends told me that company after company simply collapsed, and thousands of people lost their jobs. Now, many of them sell secondhand clothes. This one was also supposed to encourage foreign investment. But what actually happened is that local industries, such as textiles, couldn't compete with the cheap imports, and most were forced out of business. Today, secondhand clothes are practically the only affordable clothes to be had in Zambia. Supposedly, removing government subsidies was going to make Zambia more competitive. But without them, many farmers had to cut back on fertilizer and seed and were forced to grow smaller crops. As a result, more than 40% of Zambia's children are now malnourished. Meanwhile, the United States and Europe spend over $300 billion a year subsidizing their own farmers. Zambia's creditors promised this measure would generate income for the country. But since so many jobs have been lost, not many Zambians I know can afford these services at all. So the people become more and more illiterate, more and more malnourished and sickly, and Zambia's ability to attract investment diminishes even further.
Africa is facing an even greater public health crisis, an even greater crisis of impoverishment, an even greater economic crisis of marginalization than it did 20 years ago. This, to me, is the bottom line of this failed policy of the last 20 years of structural adjustment lending.
I guess you could say what Zambia's creditors promised is not exactly what Zambia got. In fact, Zambia is more in debt now than it was when these economic policies were first imposed. Which makes you wonder, doesn't it? Whose interests were they really designed to serve? Something tells me it wasn't Zambia's.
We're in a poverty trap because nobody wants to listen what the real problems are. You know, I mean, we say what our problems are, and then they turn around and say, oh, no, no, well, what is needed is a road from here to there, which nobody's going to use. So projects that you sort of stand back and you think, well, why are we borrowing money to do this?
It turns to becoming dependent if your problem's always going to be solved for you. And the manner in which it's being solved is, I don't know if I'd call it dubious, but it's a little suspect.
Today, Zambia is at the crossroads.
You are talking of these powerful international organizations. The World Bank, the IMF controls so immense resources.
9 years of reforms have had mixed results.
Those are technocrats, they are not political leaders. You have a situation where technocrats decide single-handedly the destinies of nations.
The board of the World Bank is all of the member countries, but with the voting rights assigned basically by the income level of the countries. And so what it means is that the majority power, the decisive power, is held by the rich countries. And it's really the United States. After all, the World Bank is two blocks away from the White House and three blocks away from the U.S. Treasury. So who do you think runs the show on crucial policy issues?
Growth has been uneven and on average below population growth. Worst of all, poverty is still very high. and key social indicators have stagnated. On the other hand, economic indicators have improved.
Very difficult to say what role they should play. We don't have a political colonialism, we have an economic colonialism. I think that's the easiest way of saying it. And if they can control the shots that far, then are we an independent state?
To achieve a permanent reduction in poverty, Zambia needs to continue its reform program in four areas.
Don't come into Zambia and tell us, in America we do it this way, therefore do it this way, because you're not in America anymore and we need to meet each other halfway.
You like America?
Yeah.
Why do you have that flag there?
American.
Oh,
they are good guys. Yeah.
I arrive in America is because they are too clever and they talk in terms of cash. They don't talk in terms of physical life. They talk in terms of cash.
Most of the people, they want to behave like Americans, you know? Like to behave as Americans, so after watching videos and TV, then they will come for searching for that, for such specific clothes.
World now is that of the US. The music that is enjoyed here is that of the US. It's the US once again.
Kola bonanga neke mama dictionaries mama malibuka lwa bonanga kono arafu maguri kama place yeso na ngeye. Kamana kuna kudisanga na kuwa lugo na pengi wa watama sheringwa. Mana na kula, nana kuna kula watete busiu. Ona watete kwa na niye kwa ule kuwasia.
Luka kena mwakutata bubutuna, kakuli musari ya nino kata ni mwakasi ya hae, wena manyani ba hawa saizi baba inyani wa sake na sikolo. Usika ituki saa. Besides Mama Nyando, Niba na basukolo. Pete mko kumulwa lifanga.
Asina kona follow yanga masina.
Kwani kwa bedroom? Ni lekele fya tumara tatu twinya ni fya tumazenge.
Luca is currently saving for a tin roof for his family's house, which will cost about $100. That means he'll have to sell an entire bale of clothing every month for more than a year and save almost every cent. Since he never sells the whole bale at the market in Mongu, Luka usually takes what's left to trade for fish with the villagers along the Zambezi River. Then he sells the fish in Lusaka. If he's lucky, he'll make enough money to buy another bale of clothes and put a little bit away for the roof.
Plus two, seven, plus two, nine. Thank you.
Not just about lucre or tin roofs or even second-hand clothes. It's about a whole country's struggle for survival. If you take the debt crisis and add to it the AIDS pandemic, Zambia's future looks uncertain at best. According to the World Bank, more than 80% of Zambia's population now live in abject poverty. One quarter of the workforce is sick on any given day. And there are more than 1 million orphans in the country and over 70,000 homeless children.
We've got life expectancy down, I believe, to 43 or something. We've got people not being educated on the streets selling things. And people try to say, well, yes, they're determining their own fate. Look, everything is free. Yes, everything is free, and that I welcome. A freer Zambia in terms of some of the things we're able to do. However, if we've sacrificed the education and the well-being of the people for that, then it's a question, what do we do?
Now people are dying everywhere, every day, in homes. They can't afford to go to hospitals. They have no money. Education is for the rich now only. And all this because of this terrible policies. We've never sunk so low in terms of poverty level.
However well this works, this program works, let's pretend that the World Bank have got it right. In the next generation, we're going to have this huge pool of unskilled, uncontrollable labor. I mean, over 50% of Zambia's population is under 15. What's their future?
As a result of these efforts that were begun in the 80s, we've begun to see a turnaround where growth rates, which had been falling, have begun to increase again. You know, about 4%, 5% in the second half of the 90s. So there is, in fact, some good news there. Now, but there is a disconnect. The improvement that we have seen in the second half of the 90s has not yet filtered down.
Africa's creditors would have us believe that globalization and the so-called free market economy is the solution to the debt crisis. But the truth is, in Africa today, free markets are really part of the problem. I mean, if an enterprising person like Luca is still trading used clothes for fish, who exactly is the free market for?
Globalization, marginalized people, excluded people, alienated people. I think that we reach a stage all over the world where some people have no value. They really have no role to play. From the economic growth point of view, it was as well as that they were dead or never born.
How are we going to uplift the majority of the people, for example, in a country like Zambia, who are at subsistence level, to participate and become part of the modern free market economy? It's okay for those with capital. It's okay for those with technical know-how. They can start and compete. We can talk of globalization. For the indigenous people remain as poor as before. They are not the ones who can buy the company. They are not the ones who are investing. And you say we have now a free market economy. Free market economy for whom?
If I raise enough money, I would love to go back to school, maybe even at Ivan Hone College.
I wanted to be a journalist, but I couldn't make it because I didn't have the money. So I ended up finding a job here in 1997.
This is just temporary for me. It's not a lifetime thing. It's just there to supplement my little income as of now.
I would have loved to work in an office, put on a tie nicely, then I'm in an office. Meanwhile, if any vehicle parked outside waiting for me, I would have loved that.
As my stay in Zambia wore on, I spent less time imagining who might have worn the secondhand clothes originally, and more time thinking about the people who were wearing them now. By the time I left, every American T-shirt had become a metaphor for the impossible task confronting Africa. African people are caught in a trap they did not create and cannot control. The economic policies designed to help them repay their country's debts have instead began to threaten their very survival. And I can't help but wonder, what hope do Africa's creditors have of ever recouping their loans if Africa's workforce is hungry and sick and uneducated? If we keep on this way, bending poor people's lives to suit our purposes, who will be left to make good on the debt?
Gift.
Number three, Kena Morini.
So you are the people who can help us. And if you can't help us, just leave us alone. Because the reason why you come to us is because you want to help us. If you can't help us, just go and leave us alone.
We're not just animals and grass huts. We're not just totally undeveloped. We are somewhat developed. Africa was wanted for its brawn, not its brain. Well, we developed our brain and we are still developing our brain.
The world owes Africa a fair deal. We need to be more concerned with people than we are with capital.
At the end of the day, surely Africa has got to be allowed to stand on its own two feet. We still continue to receive money. We have to pay back, and it's being borrowed for non-productive purposes. How do you prevent mistakes being made all over again?
What kind of world do we want to live in? Do we want to live in a world where one-sixth of humanity in these impoverished countries have no chance even to see their children grow up healthy?
It's never too late to correct a wrong. It's never. It's never too late to treat a patient, no matter how ill they are. There's always a possibility of survival. Even if that possibility is a tiny fraction, it has to be pursued.